In this video, I will show the display I'm used to adopt in my simplest projects, in terms of graphic needs. Nowadays, all the objects we use have a graphic user interface, so I move to it in my project also, looking for a simple solution, cheap and not affecting the overall project performance. I will refer to a 1.8 inch display with just graphics function, no touch input device, handled by ST7735 SPI controller. But this is not just a video about the display, how it's working, its handling library, and how to use it in a project. We will see also that having good results is not just a matter of a microcontroller power and performances. It's megahertz, the size of a RAM or of a display, the SPI speed or using interrupts or DMAs. We will see that one of the most important parts in a project is a software, the algorithm used developing it. And that's what makes interesting developing a project. We will see that your software matters, your routines make the difference. Let's go using the ST7735 SPI display controller. I'm looking for a display for my smallest graphics projects. I try many devices, even from STM. And STM has also a very rich solution in its Touch GFX project, which is not just a set of libraries, but a powerful system to develop graphic solutions. But what I was looking was a very simple solution, inexpensive and with a low impact on the overall microcontroller performance. So I abandoned TouchFX just for a moment. We'll see it next. I was not interested to touch devices also. And I came to this simple and cheap device, a 1.8 inch display handled by ST7735 SPI driver. And as I didn't want developing something for sure already available and ready for a usage, I looked also for a set of libraries to download. I looked for something based on HAL, that giving maybe a little lower performance than something directly working on the microcontroller bare metal, but it would allow me to better analyze it in case of needs. So I got this library on the internet. It is made by 3.c files, the low-level routines, handling the driver commands via SPI, the upper-level routines implementing graphics like squares, circles, triangles, color field or just the border, and the fair file, that is the data starter for some fonts. Library has also a demo function that I use to find the right setup configuration on my STM32 Cube IDE projects. The demo function is absolutely similar to what I already seen for Arduino, and I suppose that this library is a translation of the Arduino Adafruit libraries. All the run and test you will see here are done over a system made by an STM32F411, running at 100 MHz and setting SPI at 50 MHz. You know that 100 MHz for the microcontroller and 50 MHz for the SPI are the fastest speed available on the F411. The display driver needs an SPI port set up as an half duplex master running in poly mode. All the other SPI parameters are set as the default proposed by CubeMX. Now, as I said before, I want to use this device just implementing a basic user interface. I will mainly need to show text, rectangles and horizontal or vertical lines. On the other hand, I need a fast display handling. I need that the project using the display as an output device will be not affected in its performance by the display handling. So, while I was training using the library, I added to the demo some tests focusing on these features, collecting timings and showing it. That's my drawing test. The first part is the original demo from Adafruit. Then a series of what I call a clear screen, a full screen filling with a color. A series of horizontal and vertical lines. And characters written over a display. Every test show what I needed, and there is also a final page showing all the timing. And that's it. It's about 1 millisecond per character, 200 microseconds drawing a line, and 100 milliseconds for a clear screen. That's a little long time, and we clearly see the color scrolling over the screen. So, trying to find a solution to speed up graphics, as a first step I tried to change polling mode to DMA. Now, moving from polling mode to DMA is quite simple. First of all, I need to find the HAL SPI transmit commands used in the program. That API is called three times, in the write command function, write data and fill rectangle. Going to the first function, I just need to change the API to the HAL SPI transmit DMA, removing the last parameter that is not requested in DMA. I make the change also to the other function calls. Now, being DMA an autonomous device, I must take care to not start a new DMA transmission while the previous one is still running. This control can be simply done using a global flag that I call DisplayBusyDMA. That I will set to 1 before starting a DMA transmission, and I set to 0 through the interrupt callback indicating the complete SPI transmission. The control for a free DMA is performed by a loop waiting for a flag becoming 0 before starting a new transmission. Now I set up the callback function. Let me look for its name. I just checked the callback function is from the right SPI port. And I reset the flag. That's all. Let me add the function in the .h file and change the SPI port to DMA. Activating also interrupts. DMA is just in transmission. All the parameters left to default. Compile and run it. Now the microcontroller is receiving the program and run it. But instead of having a faster project, I get it slower. Much slower. So I try now to change it to interrupt. That is really easy to do. I just need to change transmit DMA to transmit IT and disable DMA in CubeMX, keeping interrupt active. And the program keeps slow, even more. That's the result. Let me write results in a more readable table. But why DMA is slower than polling mode? It is about doubling the time, and the interrupt is even worse. Now, trying to understand what happens on the DMA port, I collected data through my digital logic analyzer connected to the SPI port. I set up this kind of test. I enabled one pin using it as a trigger for the data collection on the logic analyzer. Then I changed the main loop in this way. I added a 1 second delay to let the SPI communication, if any, to complete. Then I raised the trigger pin for 1 millisecond. Start a clear screen. And one more 1 millisecond pulse on the trigger pin, marking the end of the clear screen. This is the data collected for the polling mode SPI. The green line is a trigger pin with the initial and final pulse. The other lines indicate the data to the display. Now, zooming in, we can follow the data transmission together with the program execution. Clear screen start lowering the chip select pin. And we can see it. Then there is a call to the set address windows function, which sends the caset 1 byte command followed by a 4 byte array. Then the array set command again with 4 byte, and finally a mainwr 1 byte command. And the same you can see on SPI. Caset, the 4 bytes of data, array set, again a 4 byte data, and the RAMWR command. After that, we'll start the two nested for loops. These start an SPI communication for a 2 bytes color array for each row and each column of the area to fill. On the logic analyzer data, we can see the 2 bytes transmission for each pixel, making the whole screen clearing. But we can see there is a very long time between every 2-byte transmission. That's because DMA and SPI devices need time to set up and start. But there is no reason to start an SPI every 2 bytes. We could store all the information in a buffer, making a communication just one time sending all the bytes. So I decided to review the whole library, optimizing the SPI handling. This is a map of the optimization I did. I will not go here showing all the single instructions I wrote or changed. Instead of it, I will show the main changes I did and the reason why. I will leave in the description a link to my GitHub page containing the library to let you download and check it. First of all, I removed the calls to the chip select enabling and disabling function. and I set up the NSS in output mode, connecting it to the chip cell pin of the display. This for sure is a minor change with probably a null effect on timing, but I like to let the microcontroller perform automatically all the jobs it can do, that saving lines of code, possible errors and headache. Enabling NSS is easy. Go to QBMX, open SPI and enable NSS in output signal. That's all. Connect the display chip cell pin to this one. Then I started to analyze the SPI data buffering. Here, as example, how I changed the writing character function. The original routine was writing one single pixel information, that means 2 bytes, in one of the 2 colors, depending by the character map. While in the reviewed library, data is stored in the buffer and sent over the SPI only one time at the end of the function. Now, moving through the original library, I noted that also drawing a line was writing 1 pixel at a time. Even in horizontal or vertical lines, that reasonably could have considered as a rectangle having one size of 1 pixel. But we can see that even slanting lines are made by horizontal or vertical segments that could be written over SPI in one single command. So I changed also the line drawing function, trying to apply this optimization. Introducing buffer, I could improve the data preparation algorithm. Here is, as example, the fill area function. While the buffer is an 8-bit integer array, as requested by HAL SPI transfer functions, I handle it here as a 32-bit array, taking advantage of the microcontroller architecture. Here, on a character pixel preparation or on the line drawing routine, this kind of optimization is meaningful. Keep in mind that a full screen clearing needs to set up information about 20,000 pixels. Having done this optimization, I started to have good results in terms of performance. But I fell into a new problem, due to the fact that the program was writing into buffer while SPI was still transferring the previous data. I will try to explain this here. Considering this diagram, the microcontroller and the DMA sharing a data buffer. And this is the time proceeding. Now, microcontroller starts to write into the buffer. Suppose it has to write a string, writing a letter A. It needs some time, and when the character is written into buffer, it starts DMA, passing the buffer address. So DMA starts reading a buffer and writing it over the SPI. It needs time, hopefully a longer time. But in the meanwhile, microcontroller can proceed autonomously and start writing the second string. But being DMA still transmitting, the microcontroller changes its data. The result is that the display will show a mistake with a mixed character that partially is A and partially B. This can be solved using 2 buffers. So the microcontroller starts writing 1 buffer. When writing is complete, it starts transmission, giving address of buffer 1 to DMA. Then it starts writing on buffer 2. And being the writing completed, microcontroller gives the buffer 2 address to DMA, that reads the right data and starts the transmission. These are the results of the logic analyzer after optimization and double data buffering. Above is what you already seen about the original library. and below the same activity, the same program, after the mentioned optimization. We have already seen that clear screen needs about 100 milliseconds with the original library, while now it takes about 6.5 milliseconds. And we can see here that the microcontroller started the second triggered signal while DMA was still transmitting clear screen. Zooming into, we can see that now there is no delay between bytes sent over SPI due to DMA start and stop. Measuring the timing, I got these results. And finally, we can see DMA helping to have a higher performance. But we still can see that when the data to transmit is short, like a simple line, polling mode is still the best performing method, so it should be a threshold defining when it's better to move data through DMA or using polling mode. Now you know that even if DMA is set on QBMX, there is still the possibility to transmit data using polling mode. So I changed my library, exactly introducing a threshold on the buffer length, deciding in each data transmission if it has to use polling mode or DMA. As you can see here, if the data size, that means the buffer length, is lower than the threshold, I'm using polling mode. Otherwise, I'm using DMA. After some test, I set as 20 bytes the most performing result. And this is the data table I got. You can see that all the timings got better. And that's the display running. Final consideration. As I stated, this timing is related to an F411 running at 100 MHz and with an SPI running at 50 MHz. But not all the displays work fine with this speed. Here you can see a display showing a wrong graphic. Lowering the SPI speed, it will start displaying correctly. I found a datasheet of ST7735, even if it is quite old, dated 2011. It shows that the serial clock cycle should be not less than 66 nanoseconds, that means 15 MHz. So here I am working on a lab test. In production project, I keep the speed below the 15 MHz. About the buffer size. A double buffer holding the data for the whole screen needs a really big memory. So I try to use a smaller buffer, measuring the effects. I introduced in library a macro constant defining the buffer size, calling it buffer level, and I measured the timing in the worst case, the full screen transmission. With a double buffer of 1 kilobyte each, 50 full screen transmission takes 349 milliseconds. Doubling the buffer size, timing reduces of 10 milliseconds, which is about 3%. To get better of another 3%, buffers must increase to 16 kilobytes each. Now, you can decide which is best for your project, but even a buffer level 10 is good, and buffer level 11 is what I normally use. and here you can see the effect of a reduced buffer. That's the delay introduced by starting a new data transmission with a second buffer. Finally, for sure, you already noted the dimming backlight. I don't like to keep the display light all the time to the full brightness. I like to have something like a standby display. If a device is not used, nobody giving commands, pushing buttons, encoders or something else, it goes in standby reducing the light. So I prepare a library allowing it. Library has a macro parameter switch, where you can decide to have a switch on-off light, setting the pin as a standard GPIO pin, or having a dimming light, driving backlight through a PWM pin. Finally, I changed fonts. You can see the original library has a different font. It is just a matter of personal taste. I adopted fonts that STM makes available in its evaluation boards. STM license allow it, as you can see in the font files, and I took advantage of it. That's all. I will leave in the video description a link to the GitHub page containing this driver. On GitHub you will find also a guide showing how to set up a QBMX project for this library and how to adapt the software and its option to your needs. Thank you for watching. See you soon.